there are many countries. Tanzania. So we ought to ask ourselves whether the essence of democracy, which is accountability, you know, exists in Africa. But again, this is something that we must do to weaken institutions so that private accumulation of capital would occur, and it is affecting social development. Look at people's access to hospitals, good healthcare, housing, jobs. The youth have no jobs. And the youth that doesn't have jobs is not an illiterate youth. These are highly educated youth. We heard about their social media connections. You have a reserve army of educated, energetic, militancy-oriented people waiting. So when we talk about the success of electoral democracy and its future in Africa, for me it looks bleak, because the social forces that will support it are marginalized considerably, as a few individuals, politicians, are amassing wealth. And so now in Africa, we have a lot of political billionaires, and probably billionaires, and that is what is happening. Neither the AU or ECOWAS has been able to stand, or SADC has been able to stand against the trend. It's happening. So it is profoundly disturbing, because democracy also has institutions that enforce rules. And you can steal, you can do whatever, but when you're caught, the institutions act, the laws are enforced. So that is something that I thought we should think about. Thirdly, our political parties have become predatory. And you ask yourself, what kind of organizations are this? When they get into government, they declare supremacy over every state institution and stop at nothing in weakening those institutions, whether intimidating, whether the civil services autonomy, the public services autonomy, the police's impartiality, and you can go on and on, are not things that they have upheld and promoted. So it has become a situation where it's all done to amass wealth, but they are least oriented towards any transformational development. The infrastructure, the roads we see, and the skyscrapers, and the new residential exclusive luxuries and so on, which they're talking about, new airports and so on, is not touching the lives of the majority of the people. And poverty, excruciating poverty, is real. Four, if you take, even before I go to four, I'm wondering, if we develop objective criteria, we can call political parties developmental. In a democracy, I know we've been preoccupied with talking about developmental states, but in a democracy, if you want to differentiate between developmental, democratic development from the authoritarian, in democracies, you need developmental parties to develop developmental states. And you wonder, Africa's need for a developmental state, whether these parties we have can do that, if we do not look at creating probably a framework or engaging them in a way that would also transform them to look at the bigger development issues. They are election machines, and election brings you wealth. And that is what the situation is. Four, nation building. I think the countries I've mentioned, South Africa, Kenya, Ghana, Liberia, even Tanzania, where Swahili unites. If you talk to people from these countries, they feel more polarized than at any other time. And sometimes you can't even tell where the sense of common identity as citizens and belonging to a nation is, except over football and sports that suddenly we are all rallying around the flag. It has become extremely divisive of already a heterogeneous society with a rich complex of diversity. And we have to ask ourselves, couldn't parties build nations? the nations that are seen to be patriotic in Europe and others were also built by parties. After all, EU was a nation of political parties. So we have to ask ourselves fundamental questions about where we are headed with the stability of our electoral democracy, whether it's translating and moving us in the direction we have to go. Finally, I believe that international commitment to either our electoral democracy or our developmental aspiration is weakening. I think it probably attained its peak between 2005 and 2011 when we had 8 effectiveness. Since then, going to Busan, coming back, we have seen significant and consistent decline in international aid, democracy support, even commitment to development. There has been a very disturbing shift from committing to any long-term project except to programs, except to projects. And indeed, governance, human rights, institution building and so on are not really, even accountability institutions are not receiving much attention. I don't think it's a bad idea for the partners to also be preoccupied with migrants and other issues they have. But what strikes me is that nowhere do you see commitment of African governments, whether at the AU level or ECOWAS level, to say that we are taking responsibility for our democratic development. And as the partners go, we have a way of building our economies and generating resources and investing them in the democratic institutions that anchor the electoral democracy that we have. So I'm sorry I haven't reflected the optimism and the enthusiasm of the trends. I am still thinking critically because I think democracy, if we don't do something, will collapse. Thank you.
And now, Dr. Ako, the political analyst, political affairs department, the African Union.
Everyone at lunch, so I'll make it 10 minutes. What I've done here is to, or what I would do now is to try and bring in or tie together certain words and phrases I've jotted in my diary. The first three are reconceptualization, redefinition, and reinvention. And linking those three words to electoral democracy as we couched it today and linking it to emerging trends in electoral processes in Africa is that I think the core issue or the core problem that we are facing is how some of our political leaders have taken it upon themselves to reconceptualize the ideal or the idea of democracy, electoral democracy, and how they've redefined it and are reinventing it through legal frameworks which they control as political elite. Now, what I will do is to read out a quote I saw in yesterday's newspapers from the president. So he says, "Some people think that being in government for a long time is a bad thing. But the more you stay, the more you learn. I am now an expert in governance." And I saw this, or it was pointed out by a very good friend of mine over lunch yesterday. And I thought to myself, this is perhaps one of the most cogent statements that underlies the ban of electoral democracy in Africa, the leadership. The second is a signboard that I saw in front of the new parliament building in Banjul. And I'll rephrase, for I don't remember exactly what it said. Unfortunately, I was in a moving vehicle, so I couldn't take a picture. But it was something like this. "We thank the president for investing in democracy by donating this building to Parliament. Unfortunately, I was alone in that vehicle, so I could only lament to the driver, who was Gambian. But he understood what I was saying, and he said to me, "Doctor, your sentiments are what the people of the Gambia feel. But unlike you, a foreigner, we cannot speak of it." And I think the thought that I will refer to is one that my director loves so much. When a president was asked the question at an interview, "When are you going to say goodbye to your people?" And he responded, "You must know something I don't. Tell me, where are my people going?" So with those three scenarios that reveal the thinking of our political elite, I then say that one of the fundamental, or perhaps even the underlying issue, and the most particular emerging trend now in Africa, is how democracy, or electoral democracy, has been reconceptualized, redefined, and reinvented. These folks are there to stay. At least that's their plan. And if that is the plan they have, all other threats, be it clamping down on communications, human rights, and the violence that they precipitate, I think it all comes down to this issue. If you want to rephrase that, put it differently, I would say that electoral democracy in Africa is suffering from the second coming of autocratic rule. And perhaps the greatest challenge, and which is what I want to put to the workshop, is how we as supposed or purported beneficiaries of electoral democracy are busy trading blames rather than looking at the positions we are in, either as citizens, as EMBs, or as international organizations, or whatever, and thinking of how, in our own various ways, we can challenge what in Nigeria will be referred to as the repackaging of democracy to be autocratic. So what I'll do is to quickly look at what I think are the positives of the different stakeholders, from international organizations down to the citizenry. And with the AU, where I've been for a few months, I find it quite interesting when that institution is bashed as much as it is. One of the things that I've discovered in my time is that the AU is trying to reach out to the ordinary person on the street. And in terms of elections and the threats to stable electoral democracy, I think I will mention just two things. The first is bringing back or re-energizing the Continental EMB Association, where they can share experiences and learn from themselves, from their mistakes, from their achievements, on how to be self-motivational in terms of having credible, free and fair, inclusive elections on the continent. The second is the recent, if I just use the term red, energizing of collaborations with political parties. So the AU Commission has signed an MOU to engage with the two foremost political parties of all member states to help with capacity building, to achieve all these things we've spoken about. How can they better serve their people? How can they better understand what their mandates, their roles are in the process? And then to national institutions, the EMDs, the human rights institutions. When are these bodies going to begin to take full responsibility for elections? We've all referred to the example of Professor Jega. Professor Jega is alive and is serving as a professor in a university. Why do other AMB chairs think that if they conduct free and fair elections like he did, under circumstances that are no worse than he faced, that it is the end for them? If indeed it is the end for them, but the beginning of a new thing for their countries, is that too much of a sacrifice? Maybe, maybe not. And then civil society, and by this I'm taking national, international, and so on. The work of international affairs with the electoral risk management tool, for instance, amongst other initiatives, is commendable. But then again, they cannot push these things at countries. EMDs, for instance, have to recognize the need for these things and request their assistance. And then finally, citizens. I think those are the ones that are most concerning, which we all are. We're happy to blame our political elites. We're happy to blame institutions such as ECOWAS and the AU. But in fact, our taxes make us the primary stakeholders. So when are we going to realize that and begin to do things differently? Again, that's a question that I hope we can engage with. It is then time for the normative framework to evolve. For we are not ruled by laws, but we make laws to rule us. So in my view, the APDEC, that's the Charter on Democracy, I think it's about time the AU as an institution taking the RECs and other member states, have a second look and determine whether or not that charter is indeed capable of facing the challenges that we face today. If not, then perhaps it's time to engage in a review. I think Professor Jega's name here now has moved from being a noun to, if I get it right, is now a verb. So we can say, when can all EMBs begin to Jega about themselves redefining what they refer to as electoral democracy? I think for now, it is being seen and considered and acted upon as an event. So the election will take place on January 1st. Rather than seeing it as a process, because the moment the election day passes, a new electoral cycle begins. So what do civil society do between that period and the next election day? So that's a question I think is most pertinent as well. And I think for citizens, which we all are, I think as a people, we also have to question what sorts of democracies do we want? How do we want that democracy or those democracies to come into play, amongst other questions? Until you realize that your voice over the period combined with others can make the changes that we desire, then we'll continue to do what I refer to as blame trading. And if I had a title for this 10-minute speech, I would call it the blame trading of the electoral process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. And our next presenter, who's standing there for all the...
Thank you very much.
And that's Professor Antonio Sudine. She is a commissioner with the Independent Nigerian Electoral Commission.
I was supposed to discuss the presentation that you made.
Yes, you are.
The microphone is here. I was listening to them like you were doing. I just want to observe that a lot of the issues that they have raised are things that are also peculiar to us in Nigeria. In the case of Cape Verde, I hear about the increasing role of the independent-minded voters versus the number of political parties. We're told that these are reducing, even though the opposition parties are increasing. We hear about the role of external agents as well, as in the sense that this is dwindling. We hear about the cost of electoral campaigns, with the effect that those who win elections, or those who tend to win, are those who can afford to have expensive campaigns. This is very common in Nigeria. Professor Akwete told us about turnout for national elections versus those for local elections. It's the same problem that we have here. We recently conducted local council elections here in the Federal Capital Territory, and in particular in the main city of Abuja, turnout was as low as 10%. Akwete also talks about ensuring peaceful elections in terms of the violence that attends elections and the need to provide security. He also talks about political millionaires, predatory political parties having no transformatory agenda for improving the lives of citizens. He talks about weighing international commitment to our democracy. That is an area that I think may not apply to Nigeria in the sense that we discussed it, because I think that in Nigeria we're actually bombarded by a lot of support in terms of the number of agencies that are interested in supporting our democratic process, but probably not in terms of the quantum of resources that they would like to put. But you see several, and I don't think that they are working in tandem with themselves or in tandem with what we would really, really like to do. I'm sure you understand what I'm talking about. Dr. Apu, on his part, talks about how electoral democracy has been reconceptualized by leaders, and the fact that democracy is suffering from the second coming of autocracy. He calls for the coalition of electoral management bodies for knowledge sharing, CSO involvement, an increased role for continental and sub-regional organizations in democratic consolidation. When we look at all of this, okay, we will see that, like Professor Ebianu mentioned, the quality of elections really remain a source of concern. I think Akwete is in agreement when he says that we celebrate near misses. You know, Mrs. Hidayat Hassan mentioned what we thought of our 2015 elections, and maybe because what was expected to happen did not happen, apart from the fact that a lot of effort was put into that, we have assumed that we have reached where we're going. But I really would like to agree that we have a long way to go, and there's need to continue to improve the election process in Nigeria. I have identified three or four areas concerning the elections in Nigeria that I think are of concern to me and to the Commission. First is the role that we play constitutionally, or we are supposed to play constitutionally. They are numerous. But I would like just to summarize that the Commission has a lot on its plate. and there's a need to unbundle, particularly when we look at the experience of other African countries. Several countries in Africa, especially Francophone, have different bodies undertaking some of the tasks that the Independent National Electoral Commission is supposed to carry out. Voter registration, for instance, political party registration and monitoring are issues. In Niger, where our chairman mentioned that we supported their recent elections in Niger and Benin, the Ministry of Interior is responsible for the register of parties and voters. It also has a constitutional court to sort and deal with complicated issues like the one we faced in the Kogi election. And in Kenya, you have a hate speech commission. This is part of the function that INEC is supposed to deal with. We have had, secondly, issues with what is commonly referred to as inconclusive elections. It is public knowledge that the commission has encountered many inconclusive elections in its short life. What is an inconclusive election? It is one where challenge ballots are sufficient to affect the outcome of an election. Put differently, it is where the total number of registered voters in units where results are cancelled or where elections are postponed are sufficient to cause a change in the outcome of the election in the affected constituency. Now, because our elections, this is really, really what we believe and what we saw from the 2015 elections, because elections are now better and keener, partly due to the use of permanent voters cards and smart card readers, also because we have stronger parties and stronger candidates, the margin between winners and runners-up is getting slimmer and slimmer. In Bayelsa, for instance, just as an example, when the incumbent governor was first elected, the margin between him and the runner-up was over 400,000 votes. But this January, when we had the election, the gap was just about 50,000. Now, in the FCT elections that I referred to, there were areas where councillors won their positions only by a margin of 11 votes. If you take that into consideration, you will see why it is necessary to give voters another chance to go back to the polls the second day or a few months after. What usually is responsible for inconclusiveness is majorly areas where you have violence, and there is a lot of violence. It has always been part of our history, but because room for manipulation is no longer there like before, you find people doing all sorts of things to ensure that you cancel and have to return. With regards to violence and the sanctioning of electoral misdemeanor and fraud, and within the context of the character of Nigerian politics, a huge geographical space and a voting population of over 70 million voting population, which is far above the population of many African countries, the capacity of the ENP to influence the quality of the election process is conditional and relies on the security agencies, of which it can only work in partnership. We can only partner with them. We cannot be responsible for conducting elections as well as securing the environment for elections. A third area of concern for me is the cost of rerun elections. We have had two states in particular where we had elections, and these were cancelled elections These were elections of 2015 that court has asked us to go back to redo. So resources have been expended in 2015, and we come to 2016 to repeat them, and we are unable to. Now, in one of the states, I looked at the budget for that state. The budget is close to ₦1 billion. The cost for the election, close to ₦1 billion. Now we went there and we could not do that exercise on the same date. We are waiting to go back. They are already asking us when we're meant to come back. But this is a place where we deployed over 20,000 ad hoc staff. This is a country where we manage to put about 4 officials at a polling unit when the general practice is about 6 and above. The general practice is also that this is done on volunteer basis, but in Nigeria you must pay for every service, especially when it is government work. Now you deploy over 20,000, you are not able to do the exercise that second time, and you have to go back a third time. The question for me is, what are the conditions for returning? How do we sanction such locations, especially in the light of wastage of time, money, and materials, and in a few instances, loss of lives of election personnel and citizens of those locations? If we are to relate it to some of the issues that have been raised in the opening ceremony by all the keynote speakers, if we are to see elections leading to or making contributions to the development process, you will see that this cannot happen when you begin to have rerun elections that are costly in the way that they are. The Commission, fourthly, has tried to make some changes in terms of some of the things it found on ground. In particular, I want to just mention the simultaneous voting and accreditation. Simultaneous accreditation and voting. What was done to reduce the problems of electoral practice was to introduce the situation where you accredit, there's time for accreditation, and you come back later, or you wait a few hours later for the voting process. You know, this had a lot of advantages. And this was, I would say, before the introduction of technology in the form of the PVC and smart calendar. Once we came in, we tried to experiment on a pilot basis. And because some of the environment where we needed to work were also not very secure, they were dangerous, we wanted to start in the morning and finish in daylight, okay? So we decided, let's try a situation where you accredit and vote and go home. This has worked to a large extent. However, a major area of problem that I think that we have now is that because people are unable to do much, to do anything negative in the process of voting, accreditation of voting, what do we see? Particularly in the reruns we have had, people are snatching result sheets. So they are going to the end of the process. They used to be at the beginning of the process. Now they are going towards the end. You find coalition officers not showing up at the last minute. And they also collect their result sheets where they are supposed to be responsible for coalition, and they never show up. Now, free and fair elections, we all agree, are cornerstones of democratic societies. And one of their central characteristics is that they are judged free and fair, and that every citizens' vote counts equally. However, we have come to, it is, and it's now necessary to raise issues about this belief, whether it is the people's votes that count or the record that the people who manage elections actually keep, including us, members of the commission. You know, is it the vote of the voter that counts, or it is we, or that the collation officer, what he decides to put to record that really matters? Therefore, it has been found that there, even though there are other ways of tampering with election outcomes, such as redrawing district boundaries, known as gerrymandering, or barring certain demographics from their right to vote, ballot fiddling goes on. There's the introduction of large numbers of false votes and the destruction of real ones, through, in particular, this snatching of result sheets and the introduction of those sheets, you know, in ways that they introduce them into the result collation process in ways that affect the results that you get at the end. Dialogue with EMBs in Africa that may be involved in e-collation, okay? A situation where it should be possible to transmit results straight from the polling unit to a central collation center. So we're interested in and exploring the possibility of electronic transmission of results from the polling unit to the collation center. Unfortunately, the major hindrance to this that I see for now is that of infrastructure issues. I would like to thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. We've had the presentations here that were very sound and very informative. But the question still remains, where are we going wrong? Where are we going wrong? Here we are sitting here talking, I don't know, we are talking to ourselves probably. We are talking to ourselves. Where are, aside from the electoral management bodies that are supposed to be apolitical, where are the politicians, where are the practitioners? We will go on talking as think tanks. Where are the think tanks for? What is the relationship between the think tanks and the politicians? The political leadership itself, the presidents. Do you ever think there will come a time when we can set up an orientation academy for the political leadership? When a president gets into power, the first thing that he or she must do is to go to school on how to govern properly. Because we keep on coming up with these wonderful ideas, but really they never get translated. Where are we getting it wrong? Otherwise, we continue discussing and crying and mourning with no results, really. Because as everyone was saying here, when people get into power, it doesn't matter how good they were as ordinary citizens, as academics, and so once they get there, the piece of work they have to do, one, is impossible. All those promises that we're making, they are impossible to realize because, one, the cake is too small, there's a whole lot of manipulation, and all the support that you are getting even from the international community. Once you have delivered, the vote has been declared free and fair, that's it. And then after that, you are on your own. So what we do, what we suggest the people that we facilitated to get into power, if there is no link between the think tanks, we remain ivory tower. And even if you get the papers there, they are not ready. I think we really need to think of new ways of engaging politicians, because really our integrity as academics, as EMBs, is at stake. It's not even at stake. It doesn't amount to anything. So what do we do? How do we rethink this whole idea of connection, so that at the end of it, our efforts in conceptualizing things in analyzing the situation, in contributions as EMBs, actually in the end bear fruit for the benefit of the society for whom we are supposed to be working. I would like to thank you all for listening and taking part. Unfortunately, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
He said to individualize that better.
Yeah. Actually, I will switch it to 30. Okay. Thank you. May we have...
I want to respond briefly to some of the very, very provocative insights offered by the three initial speakers and by the keynote speaker. You see, I think what we need to talk about is not to talk about the paradox of democracy, of elections. We need to talk of what the Argentinian political scientist talks about, the perpetual crisis of democracy. Democracy is always evolving. It is evolving because it's also part of the process of struggle. If you look at it from the time of Plato, has been involved in struggle, was the rejection of liberal democracy. And if you look at various African constitutions, a major dimension is what we refer to as chapter 2 here, where you redefine the whole concept of, you know the liberals in the West, they go on to the concept of human, of economic rights, social rights. They rejected it vehemently. But the African Charter of Humans and Peoples brought that in. And in every African constitution, we now have that chapter 2 that is basically redefining the states and the responsibility of the states. Now, we need to push that struggle forward. And some of the sites here is again through the APRM, where you find African consultants looking at what is going on the ground. And I think two basic issues is that we have redefined the state. We have redefined the state in a more inclusive way, and also talking about the social responsibility of the state. Now, we are still in that struggle. In many countries, Chapter 2 is not being